इंटर्नशिप प्रोग्राम बाय गूगल।
दिस कॉल इज नाउ बीइंग रिकॉर्डेड।
हेलो, या ओके, सो वी कैन मूव ऑन टू द नेक्स्ट स्लाइड। एंड सो वी वुड लाइक टू वेलकम आवर स्पीकर्स साम्या एंड अरुंधति, हु हैव इंटर्न प्रीवियसली। सो अ लिटिल ब्रीफ अबाउट देम। साम्या वॉज अ फाइनल ईयर स्टेप इंटर्न इन 2019 एंड SWE इंटर्न in 2020 in Google, and Arundhati is a pre-final year step intern and 2020 upcoming SW intern. So thank you so much for giving your time to, you know, talk about your experience and about Google. So
yeah, thank you so much for having us.
Yeah, it's a really pleasure to be here with all of you.
Great, it's good to hear that. So we can begin, and so let's start with the introduction to the STEP internship program. So Samya and Arundhati, you can begin.
Okay. So as all of you would know, STEP internship is an internship primarily for second year female students that Google offers. And I think it is one of the most prestigious opportunities for second years out there. You get to have an exposure to the corporate environment, learn how the development happens in a more corporate way, and you know, the entire 10x thinking that we have at Google. You really get to learn what the thinking behind all your favorite apps is. Arundhati, would you like to add anything?
Yeah, you pretty much covered everything. So obviously a big plus point is that you get to have like genuine corporate experience in your second year, so that is why this internship is very like exciting and a really good opportunity for female students. And also, if you perform well in this internship, you get to come back to Google the next year and intern as an SW intern, and then if you do well again, then you may actually get a job at Google. So it is best to, like, if you get your way into Google in your second year only, like, that's pretty cool.
So Arundhati, would you like to like talk about the timeline?
Samya and my timelines were different. So I actually someone's mic is on. Anyway, for me, the Google came to our college to recruit. So that's why we had to submit our resumes at around in the first week of December, and then by mid-December we had our interviews, and then by like end of December we had the results. So Samya had a slightly different experience because she applied off campus. She'll talk about that.
Yeah, so I applied through a senior who is currently working at Google. So he had put out requests asking if we wanted referrals. And so I asked him for a referral in December, but I had to wait till January to have my interviews. And then it was another 3 months of wait until April beginning that I got to know that I had been accepted. So applying off campus can cause the timeline to extend a lot, while when you're on campus you'd probably have your results within 2 weeks of applying. And I think the process for interview is pretty much the same whether you apply off campus or on campus. You have the two interview rounds, both of them are 45 minutes each, and you'll have a break in between. Arundhati, would you like to add anything?
Yeah, I had the same experience. So on the same day, I had two interviews of 45 minutes each, and we had around 15 minutes of break in between. So that's pretty much it. In some cases, some people also have three interviews, but that's like based on the hiring committee's decision if they think that they would like to conduct another interview. But otherwise, it's usually two interviews on the same day.
And all of you must already know that during these interviews, you're supposed to write the code in a Google Doc, and we'll be sharing more tips later on in the presentation. So we'll start with some basic resume tips because that's some of the questions we receive. Like a lot of questions were related to how to make your resume stand out or how to stand apart from your peers. So I think for me, I think each resume looks different, and you can probably, if you are a person who loves development, then you can have a very dev-oriented resume where you have projects that show that you have worked a lot. You could have, say, GSOC experiences. You could have projects you've done in college. And the other route to go is to go through a competitive programming route. So you might be really good at CP and have gone through coding competitions such as Kickstart or HashCode.
Yeah, also it's worth mentioning that even if you don't have any like a very specific resume, it's fine. The basically the point is that it's a common misconception that you have to focus on CP to get into Google or any other big company. That's not true at all because things are changing now. So, you know, just do what interests you and try to stand out with your resume and not just try to follow what everyone's doing. But in Google's case, Google organizes some coding competitions. So if you participate in them, you automatically go into their database and they may contact you for internships and jobs.
Yeah, like it's just a general advice. If Google is really a goal, those competitions are a good way to get into their database. It's always good to mention what technical courses you've done. So whatever course you've done during your first year and second year, try to mention them because it shows that you already what all knowledge do you already have. That can always be a great thing to add. And one of the biggest misconceptions that we've always heard is, you know, having a really great GPA. But over time, talking to various Googlers during our internships, we've realized that it really doesn't matter. You don't have to be, you know, a 9-pointer or a 9.5 plus GPA person to get an internship or even a job at Google.
Yeah, I feel like for the so before the interviews, you obviously have this resume shortlisting round where they just you go through a resume and pick people for the interviews. So I think in that step, the GPA only matters so much. There were a lot of questions saying that if my GPA is not above 9, then will my chances be affected? That is not the case. When I applied, I had a GPA of 8.9, so it's lesser than 9. And yeah, I think if you have a G, it is generally considered that if you have a GPA above 8, 8.5, then you're pretty good you have a pretty good candidature. So just focus on the rest of your resume and, you know, improve your projects or something else. So basically, you're put into the same pool once you have a GPA over 8. They won't pick you against other people who have better GPAs. So don't stress about your
I mean,
GPA at all.
I completely agree. Even for like when we had our returning offers, that was one of the last things we were told that committee looks at. What they rather look at is what feedback you get from your interviewer, etc., etc. But grades, like an above 8 GPA is good enough to get you through. Okay, let's talk about some interview prep tips. Arundhati, would you like to start?
So as you can see, the topics are mostly things that you have done in DSA, plus other like simpler things that they wouldn't have covered in your college DSA course, like sliding window or two pointers. But that is pretty much it. You don't have to do really like bitmask DP or try, etc. Like those complicated data structures, you don't have to do them at all. So just get your DSA concepts clear.
Yeah, and it really helps if you decide on a particular language, because what they'll do a lot of time is that they'll ask you questions that are specific to the language you're coding in. So if you pick C++, they might ask you like, okay, the C++ library that you're using, what's the ON complexity that it uses for the insert or delete? Like those things really matter, and you might look over it, but knowing those small details can really make you stand out.
Plus, yeah, go ahead.
those like tiny, tiny details are always very helpful, and you need to have a really good grasp of the language that you're going to code in.
Since you'll be coding on, so these interviews are held over Meet, and then you have to code on a Google Docs. So you won't have those like text editor features like code completion, etc. So you need to know your language really well, and you need to solve a lot of similar problems that come in interviews beforehand. So you know that, okay, this data structure requires these methods. So if you forget some stuff, that's fine. They can let that pass, but then you can't write a pseudo code. Never write a pseudo code in your interview.
That's very true. I think that's why like having mock interviews is really helpful. So if you can find anyone, maybe it's even someone, a peer of yours, you can just ask them to give you a question, and then you code it out on a doc and you time it, like how much time does it take you to reach the answer. So that can be a really good practice. And also because we'll discuss this later on also, but during your interview, you're expected to think out loud. And generally, when we're trying to solve any CP problem or anything, we used to just think in our head and not really say out loud what our thought process is. So having mock interviews can really set you up for success by, you know, getting you used to the idea of talking out loud and listening to what your interviewer is saying. Arundhati, could you talk about the resources that you use for preparation?
So in the months leading up to the interview, the application deadline, I was consistently practicing on LeetCode, but not just like haphazard questions. I think the LeetCode question problem set is really huge and really scattered. So I use LeetCode mostly for LeetCode contests, which I think are a really good way of just approaching different topics without knowing what the topic is beforehand, and you'll have some set time to do these. It's like a competitive programming platform, but these are like actual interview questions. So I really like using LeetCode for the contest. So they have bi-weekly and weekly contests, so those are good. And I think my major practice was done over interview bit. Even Samya can talk about it, because she actually recommended this to me when I was preparing, and I asked her for tips.
So InterviewBit is a really good platform to, you know, brush up your basics and get used to certain very specific problem that tends to come in questions, interviews for various companies. So they'll have it under various topics. So you'll start out with arrays, then you go to strings, stacks, queues. So in that sense, it's very it's a very compiled version of questions. So it gets you started and gets you in that headspace that, you know, how you're supposed to go through questions of a particular topic. But then LeetCode helps you by giving you questions from random topics. So that makes you even better at coding and thinking.
And InterviewBit also has this mock interview feature where you have to take the mock interview of a stranger and they'll take yours. So it's a pretty cool feature. I took one mock interview from InterviewBit before my interview, and I think it turned out pretty good. So it's good practice. You can use that as well if you're not comfortable approaching your peers. And also, I see a question in the chat that what is the difficulty level of these questions. So I think people got it wrong. So it's not a, so LeetCode is not a competitive programming platform. What I meant was that you are given like 3 questions and around, I guess, 1.5 hours to solve all of them. So that is what I meant. So they're good for like timed practice, because you can spend hours doing one question, but if you are given 1.5 hours to do 3 interview questions, it is very similar to giving an actual interview, right? Because these are questions that have been asked in interviews before. So it's the level, I would say, is much simpler than CodeForces, because firstly, so if you have given CodeForces contest, the first like 3 paragraphs of the just some random stories, so that is like that is not there in LeetCode. Questions that are just like on point and ask you to solve the question as they are.
Yeah. Moving on to the things you need to keep in mind during your interview. So as you mentioned before, paying attention to the interviewer is very important. Like what a lot of interviewers tend to do is they'll give you a very vague question and you're supposed to ask them further question to clarify it. And for example, you can ask them for test cases. You can ask them to clarify the question. It's completely fine to do that. And very often they expect you to ask them these questions. What they'll also do is they'll drop hints while you're trying to code. So if there's a question you're taking a lot of time in, so they might just ask you, okay, what will happen if this is the scenario? So then you realize that, okay, you missed this end case. So go now. Another thing they can always ask you is if you end up completing the question, they can sometimes ask you that, you know, if you were to give this question, what end cases would you look for? Like, what are the edge cases that you would look for? And so that's one question that I was asked. Like, I was given a question, I solved it, and then they asked me, okay, what are the edge cases?
One tip I got before my interview was that know that the interviewer is your best friend. So you're just free to ask him anything. If you have some qualms about the problem statement, you're not sure what it is asking, or you're just sort of confused, just talk to the interviewer as freely as you can, like they're your peer or something. And so a lot of interviews, at least my interviews, went really smoothly just because I was just conversing with my interviewer the whole time and they helped me arrive at the answer if I was stuck.
Yeah, and don't give up. I remember when I was giving my first mock interview, I was like, I don't know how to solve this question because I hadn't prepared a lot at that time. So the person who was taking my mock interview told me, don't stop, just keep thinking whatever it is, even if it's a brute force implementation, even if it's an implementation that takes a lot of time, just go ahead and tell me what it is and then keep building on it. So that's why a lot of times people are given this advice that, you know, start with the brute force. The entire idea behind that is that even if you can't think of the final solution, don't worry about it. At least start somewhere. I think that's something you should do if you're really unsure of the question that you're given. And also, one thing that I have heard some Googlers say is that they can often tell if they give someone a question and this person has already done that question beforehand. And they advise that you should be honest with your interviewer and just tell them that, okay, I have seen this question before and I know how to solve it. So what will happen in that case is that interviewer will either tell you that, okay, it's okay, just tell me how to do this, or they'll give you a new question. Anandhati, anything else that you have in mind?
No, I think that pretty much covers this one.
Yeah, so Anandhati, how was your virtual internship this year?
So it was pretty good until I heard, so I did not know what the experience last year was. So when we were making these slides, Samya and I got talking, and I thought my interview experience was really good until I heard hers. So mine was entirely over Google Meet. We use Google Meet for everything, for our meetings, for just fun sessions, for games, and some events were common in both of our experiences, but so we did not have any virtual offsites or those things that Samya will talk about. Also, this is the swag that we got this year, so yeah, that pretty much made my month.
Yeah,
I would say.
I think one thing that was common from last year's internship and this year was the leadership sessions, which are always really amazing sessions because you have these industry experts coming in and talking about a certain topic. And those are very interesting because they talk about what Google is doing or what Google is planning to do, and they can be really informative. And you obviously get to network a lot. So there are a lot of casual sessions that happen throughout your internship. Even this year, they made it a point to have sessions on Fridays with our with one of the HR people. So we had a group and we would like get together every Friday, talk and play games. So,
in fact, like every Friday, my team, so I was working with the Google Maps team. So the entire team will convene over Meet and just play Scribble or Damshara. So they're like people who are much, much older than you. They're the managers of our managers and they're joining into play. So it's a pretty open and really sort of liberal work culture. It is pretty fun. Like nobody, I think nobody really, you know, nobody calls each other sir. Everyone calls each other by their first name. And everyone is just very lively and just wholesome, friendly, helpful, wholesome. I think that pretty much sums up the people I know.
Yeah, I mean, they'll have sessions with everyone and you'll also like get to interact with people who are managing teams and even they'll be like, hey, just address me by my first name, don't call me, you know, sir or something. So that's like a really, that's an environment where you're treated as an equal. This is one thing that I loved about the internship was that your opinion mattered as much as the opinion of someone who is leading the team. You count in the conversation and you're held responsible for the work you do. I think that's one of the very important takeaways from the internship. And another thing was that, obviously, the swags that we get, there's so many, and those are always really nice perks. And we also had, they'll have like sessions where all the interns can come together and participate together. So this year, because obviously it was virtual, so everything happened over Google Meets, but otherwise they'll have various events. So for example, we had one offsite during our internship last year, where all the interns, all of them who were interning in Bangalore as well as the ones interning in Hyderabad, got to get together and, you know, spend a day together playing games and participating in competitions together. So it's always a very fun time. The Google HR team makes sure that, you know, you are having your best experience at Google. And they really ensure that you have a healthy work-life balance. One thing I've always seen from both my hosts and co-hosts, whether it was this year or last year, was, you know, don't overwork yourself. That's what they kept telling us, that like take time out for yourself. And those are the ideals that company stands by, and that's what makes it unique for me. Anything else other than that?
No, I think, I mean, for me, I think we did very frequently overwork ourselves, but that's just like the curse of work from home, because you just want to prove that you're doing, like, you're not wasting time at home, you're actually doing work, and you actually end up doing more than you would in the physical office.
But I think almost a lot of interns ended up doing more work than was originally planned for them this year, this time around, because everyone I talked to was like, okay, I completed way more than was planned, because everyone was really trying to prove themselves. And when it's virtual, you don't really know how to judge things, but your team is always very supportive. These are some photos that we found from this year's internship, and the ones from the office are the ones are from my internship last year. So as you can see, we used to have these meetings, like 16 of us used to be with one of the HR team members, and we would just be having fun. It's an amazing experience. If you get to be a part of it, take the most advantage of it. Mm-hmm. Arundhati, what's your post-step experience been like?
Post-step, I was really fortunate that I got a PPI, so which is a return offer for an internship next year. But otherwise, I was also contacted by a lot of recruiters on LinkedIn to apply to their internship programs. So obviously, Google holds a really important brand value, and that attracts other companies to hire you as well. Because if Google has hired you, you obviously have some skills that everyone is looking for. And and just like awesome memories. I met one of the nicest and smartest, nicest and most humble and smart people of my life, as you would expect from Google. So it was just an awesome memory overall.
Like, for example, I'm still in touch with my co-host from last year, and she has been an amazing mentor to me, and she has always been like, reach out to me whenever you want, if you ever want any advice. So everyone's very welcoming and everyone wants to see you succeed. So that's all we had prepared for you guys. We're open for any questions that you might have.
I think there are lots of questions in the chat.
Yeah, so thank you for that amazing, amazing webinar. So I think we can start by taking the questions that are in the chat box.
Yeah.
So Niharika, I think this was discussed too, but still, like, if you could have a recap, it's better only. So which platform should I use for CP?
So if you want to do competitive programming, only then I'll recommend doing competitive programming. Otherwise, you don't need to do competitive programming to get a job. But if you are interested, because I enjoy competitive programming, so I really like Codeforces. I think it's a pretty competitive, it's, I think, the most widely used platform. Codeforces is good. If you're starting out in competitive programming, you might feel overwhelmed with by Codeforces, so I would recommend just do leap code contests. Those are pretty good for beginners. Yes. Okay.
Oh, okay. So I
does
missed
that answer your question.
Okay. Could you share your timeline for your prep?
So I think I actually missed one question by Ananya, which is when to apply.
Okay, when to apply. So as you mentioned, the applications usually start in November or December. So there are usually three or four ways to apply. First is through on campus, which will most likely happen in December. Referrals also happen in December. I think you can also check out the Google Career platform to see when the applications go live. So you can start looking at it from November and December. And the final is obviously that if you're lucky enough, you might get a mail from a recruiter themselves asking for you to apply. That also happens.
Yeah, that is the charm of participating in Google competitions, because if they see that you're a second year female student, they may directly contact you over mail. So that is one way. Otherwise, you can always apply on the portal. I think one point we missed in the slides was that keep an eye on the portal. So there's a notification bell thing there. So just they'll send you alerts if there are new openings or positions. So that's how you get to know. And if you're from IIIT, most probably Google will approach campus too.
Yeah, and you have seniors to reach out.
Yeah.
For reference.
Also, one thing we forgot to mention, Samya, is that for IIIT students, we both unanimously agree that you should do CP1.
even if you don't like to do CP,
you should still do that course just because of the high learning value of that course.
And some of the basics that were covered in CP1 also helped me in my interview preparation.
So I hope, Ananya, that answers your question, so we can move to question by another Ananya. Could you share your timeline for your prep?
So when I read about the referral in early December, I think that's when I started preparing again. But the thing to keep in mind was that during my summer I was already doing a lot of competitive programming because I had taken a course. So that had already given
CP1.
Me, yeah, CP1. So that already gave me a good foundation because we were supposed to do code chef contests. So later on, when I picked it up again in December, it was slightly easier for me to get used to it because I already had a good foundation. So I prepared for about a month or so. I think I had a month before my interview actually happened.
Yeah, likewise. I also, most of my preparation was indirectly through CP1 during the summers. During the semester, I did plan on doing a lot of lead code, but I just didn't find time. So I would just do the contests, the bi-weekly contests that I talked about. And I think my main preparation was in December when I just consulted Samya and she recommended InterviewBits. So it's a really good resource. So that's what I mainly use for my preparation.
Okay. Yeah, sorry.
Nothing, I was just reading the question.
Oh, yeah. If it's possible for you to read them yourself, you're free to read them yourself.
Which question should we take next, Angel?
There's a question.
By Nikita.
Late November, early December is usually when I have seen people being approached or Google coming to campuses for step applications. Is it CP or DSA? Okay, DSA, pay attention to DSA because it will create a very good foundation because that's what they focus on. They do, however, go a little bit above DSA. For example, they'll ask certain questions that can be a level above your usual DSA course. That's why we would recommend that you do some preparation from sites like InterviewBit and LeetCode. Did you apply for Step In? So Ayushi has asked if we applied for Step In first year itself. No, second year.
Didn't even know about Step.
Yeah. Yes, I applied in my third semester, end of my third semester.
Yeah, same. End of third semester. Regarding the GPA, what if it's less than 8? Would it affect our chances of getting selected? So, GPA, I think, only matters till the resume round. If you clear the resume round, then everything depends on your interview. But for the resume round, you can always make up for the GPA. GPA is not the only thing they're looking at. So they're looking at your projects and maybe some work experience that you had. Apply anyway. I don't think, they don't decide ki theek hai 8 se upar hai to isko le lenge. There were a lot of people actually in my year who I knew had a better GPA than me, but they did not even clear the resume round. So I think something I did right was in choosing the projects that I put on my resume.
I agree with Arundhati completely. I've seen a lot of my seniors apply for internships, and even if they did not have like a 8 GPA, like a below 8 GPA, they were still getting through some of the most prestigious internships and job offers just because they had the projects or some competitions to back up that they had that potential and they were willing to work hard. So, there are ways to make up for the GPA. It isn't the one final criteria ever. Okay, so how to get referral?
Yeah. I think I met an engineer at... Oh yeah, so one of my mentors said that when he graduated, he had a GPA of 7 point something. That's completely fine. Right after he graduated, he got a job at Google. So it doesn't matter that much, clearly.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was it.
Ayushi has asked how to get a referral if Google doesn't visit your campus. So Ayushi, I think one thing you can do is see, the best way is to see if there's any senior of yours who is currently working at Google. That's how at least I got my referral, because a senior of ours posted that he was working there and he wanted to give people referrals. And I think a lot of times having a network on LinkedIn is very important, because what will happen is that a lot of Googlers will post that, you know, I want to give referrals. But a lot of times what I've seen for these referrals is that they look at how good you are at CP. That's what my experience has been. I might be different for other people. For what my experience has been, that they will look that, okay, what's your code chef rank, or what is your code forces rank? So basically they want something that can back up the fact that you are a good candidate.
Yeah, even when I did not know that Google is approaching coming to our college to take recruits, I would randomly go on LinkedIn and just search Google IIIT Delhi, like alumni from IIIT Delhi who's working at Google. So I found someone who only asked to look at my resume. And there was also someone who wanted to see some like experience in CP. So till my third semester, I did not do any CP. So I did not have a code forces rank or anything like that. So that just depends on the person referring you. I think that's very rare that they would like to look at your code forces profile. Mm-hmm. Mostly they'll just want to look at your resume and just ask you a few questions.
Yeah.
If at all. Otherwise, aadhe to aise hi de dete hain.
Yeah, so it's first and foremost, see if an alum is working at Google, reach out to them. Or if that's not possible, then look for people on LinkedIn who are ready to give referrals, because mm-hmm. they'll generally post about it. Next question is, are basic software dev skills required, like familiarity with CSS and HTML?
No, they teach you there.
They do teach you there, but obviously, as part of your coursework, you do get to learn certain languages and how to code, but you don't need to be like proficient or know too much. You learn during the internship.
One thing we forgot to mention is that at Google, when you're interning, so for the first, maybe for the half, for half of the internship, they just ask you to go through
tutorials and everything.
Tutorials, etc. So I found really good tutorials on web development, Java servlets, etc., Django, React. So they have all that content. So unfortunately, my internship was very, very short because of some issues. So mine was only 6 weeks long. That's why we did not really get to do the learning bit. But Samya's internship, which was 12 weeks long, I think for about half the internship till last year, they were supposed to learn and build some really small project from the related to the topics they learned. And then they start working on the actual project in the next 6 weeks of the internship. Is that right?
It depends on your host, your manager is. That is, I've seen happen. That's how my host this year actually planned my internship. So I was supposed to learn about certain software, because a lot of things that you're supposed to do during your Google internship, the tools that you're using, are completely internal. So the chances are that you might not even know how to use those things. So they give you the time. They'll be like, okay, go through these tutorials, try them out, and you know, follow them. So that's so they give you the time to brush up and learn new things. So it shouldn't. You don't need to be really proficient, and especially when you are a second year intern, they are very understanding of the fact that you're just a second year, and they're very supportive. And they allow you the time to, you know, grow and learn, and they're there to help you out. And I think next question would you like to answer?
Which
question? Will lead code easy and medium questions do?
Or should hard? No, I don't think hard questions will be asked. Easy and medium is fine.
Yeah.
Which
so
course?
Jan, I think Angel answered it already.
Okay.
I think we can start from Mahima's question, which is what kind of projects should we have in our resume?
Anandhati, would you like to talk about what projects you had?
Again, their understanding of the fact that you're just a second year student, you won't have exceptional projects on your resume. So I put three projects, and two of them were from a course called IIT, which we have in IIIT Delhi. So I knew that in this course, everyone's project is unique. So that is something that would make my resume stand out, right? Because the third project that I put was a course project that everyone else did in my batch. So I made sure that the other two projects that I put are unique to me, that nobody has on their resume that I can talk about. So so I chose only three projects because those were the only, I think, major projects I had in three semesters. And they know that they wouldn't expect a second year student to like have ML projects or anything of that sort on their resume. So just choose, like, go through your projects and just choose the ones that look best to you. That would be my best advice.
Yeah, I think I agree with Arundhati because I also had that course and we had done something related to virtual reality. So that was a very unique project, and that's what I added in my resume along with some other course projects. Again, the same thing that Arundhati said, it's always, if you have the time, however, we would always encourage you to take up your own projects because that always adds to your resume.
Yeah, if you have personal projects, then feel free to put them as well.
Yeah. Another thing is feel free to even add your co-curricular achievements and anything you might have done. For example, I had done a sort of a temporary TA-ship where I was teaching these two students who had come to our college. I was teaching them systems management. So that's something I had added to my CV, which I thought would add something unique. How profound is one should be in advanced data structures like graphs, DP, greedy, and especially heap? Heap is important for sure.
Yeah.
Heap and graphs.
Mm-hmm. Dynamic programming, they won't ask, most probably. Maybe just basic DP questions like subset sum or maximum increasing subsequence or stuff like that. But I don't think, I mean, from the people I know, nobody was asked questions on DP. Graphs can come. Greedy, maybe very basic questions that they would expect you to know. And heap is actually a pretty, I think, popular question to give.
For example, many questions are asked quite a lot, I think.
Yeah, one of my classmates who had her interview, she was basically given the basic structure of the heap ka code, and then she was asked to add some modifications or something like that. So that also requires you to know how a heap works. I don't know how heap is that popular among Googlers, but it is very frequently asked in interviews.
I think we can go on to Ayushi's question, which is, did you have an internship before STEP?
No, nothing. I had no experience, any work experience before my STEP internship. And I don't think, I mean, it's good if you do it. Obviously, it will make your resume stand out, but it's not a hard and fast rule.
I've read an article on LeetCode where they have mentioned they ask questions they wish data structure is best for the problem. Can you please explain what the question was?
Arundhati, could you read the question out as well, because
yeah,
in the recording?
Yeah, I should. So the question is, I have read an article on LeetCode where they have mentioned that they ask questions like which data structure is best for the problem. Can you please explain what the question revolves around? So I'll just give an example of the question I got in my interview. So it was basically, I don't quite remember, but it was something to do with finding duplicates in an array. So one thing you can do is just do brute force, have two pointers go through the array, like compare every two pair of numbers and then see if they're duplicates. Or what you can do is use a binary search tree, like put everything in a binary search tree. Or you can just use hash maps and then just compare. So I won't go into the details. So in this question, I explained to the interviewer that we can use binary search keys. We can also use hash maps. So they could pose a question that if I had only mentioned binary search tree, they could question me that, do you think you can do better with a different data structure? So obviously there's a hash map which has a complexity of O1, and that reduces my problem to have O(n) complexity instead of O(n log n) complexity, which I would have had I used a binary search tree. But I think that is what they mean. Like, you need to know your data structures very well so that you know that, okay, in this question, I can really reduce the complexity by using a heap. I can change it to n log n. So stuff like that. It's very similar to finding the best, complexity for your algorithm, for the problem. I hope that answers your question.
Next question is, could you mention any other internships for second year students? There is Microsoft that does its Codeus program. I think Amazon also started. Angel, do you know?
Think it did start a Amazon WoW program, but I'm not sure if it's,
for second year students.
Okay. Although there is Outreachy and GSOG, which you can try your hands on in the second year itself. Mm-hmm. Also, there's one by Adobe, but I'm still not sure if it's for the second year or not. One thing which I can do is, Women in Tech IITD has its website wherein all these opportunities are posted. So I can put the link in the chat box and you can explore those opportunities and see if anything fits the second years. Also, if you want some resources on CP, DSA, systems questions, so we have all that on the website as well. So I'll just put in the link and everybody can just probably have a go. And if something you find helpful, then it's an accomplishment for us only. So I'll just put it in the chat box and towards the end of the session, and you guys can have a look.
Yeah, that would be great. Do the projects you make in a group in a hackathon can be added in the resume? Definitely yeah. Do that, because hackathon projects tend to be very unique most of the time, so it's always a good addition and it shows that you are doing things other than your academics. This internship is only for second year BTech students. To answer Sakshi's question,
can you tell what your project were about that you had put in your resume? So one project was a course project I had done in my course Advanced Programming. So we had to make basically the game Plants vs. Zombies for PC. So that is what the project was. My other two projects were my IED project. So one was just shoes that create music when you dance wearing them, and one other project that I put was a very basic sort of ice dropper sort of thing that measures the liquid in your glass and pours ice. So just projects I had done in my course.
So as I mentioned, there was one that I'd done, which was a virtual reality with Arduino integration. The other project was again a course project. We had to implement a game on for PC using Java, and then I had added a project that a very small project that we had done about, which was a smart lamp. How to say persistent in coding? For me, I think interview bit has helped me to at least get through all the questions of various topics and have a good understanding. Because the questions will be very tricky and frustrating, but it always helps if you try to solve them, even if it takes you time. And if you are able to even solve them partially, it always is recommended. At least I've always been recommended this that if you are able to, if you solve any question, go and look at other people's solution on it and look at the top solutions, because that will tell you a better way to implement it. And you might learn something in the process.
Is there some minimum rating that you need to have in CodeForces and CodeChef in order to make your resume stand out? I don't think so. Samya, what's your
I hadn't put my rating, so I wouldn't really know about this.
Yeah, I don't think I had put that either. I just put my LinkedIn and GitHub profiles, nothing else.
Yeah, same. What is the selection process? Anyone who applies is shortlisted for the interview. So as Arundhati and I mentioned, there is a resume selection process that happens, and after that you have your interviews.
So in last year when I applied, I don't know how many girls are in my batch, but I think around 10 got shortlisted for the interviews, and out of that 6 got selected. I think these are all the questions.
Okay, there are more.
Can I get unique ideas for my project? I think, as someone already mentioned, hackathons are a very good way of just, you know, it puts you on the spot to brainstorm an idea and come up with a project. So I think hackathons are a good way of finding projects. I think there was, just a second, I'll look for a, we can go on to the next question. I'll look for a website that I was recommended by a senior when I was asking about like what projects to look into.
Okay. Are there any scholarships for girls? I think Angel, can you, Angel would have a lot of, probably have resources for this.
We have resources for this as well. But yeah, so WTM, which is Women Tech Makers Scholarship, I think, is a scholarship for women. I think GHC also allows first years to participate. GHCI doesn't. GHC, I think it does. Other than that, there are some by Adobe. Yeah. You could have a look at those. Other than these, I am not very they are not really on my tips right now. But I'll just put in the website link right now only. So you guys can probably have a look. We have all the resources, etc., written here. So go have a look. These are like a lot of opportunities. Yeah, so I think you can just explore the website and get ideas where to apply, etc. Till that time, we can have more questions if there are. Oh yeah, Arundhati has also posted the, dev folio link for project ideas.
Yeah, there's some cool projects that people have done before in hackathons, so you can go through them. And there's some, I think, 6 project ideas as well that you can explore. You're welcome.
Yeah, so are there any other questions? Okay, so I think we are right on time, to be honest. It's dot five. So thank you, Samya and Arundhati, for this amazing, amazing session. I learned a lot personally as well, and I'm pretty sure all our attendees also learned a lot. So yeah, you're getting a lot of thank yous as well. So I hope all of you learned, and it was worthwhile your time to attend our webinar. So thank you guys, and I shall be stopping the recording now.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Angel and Ayush.